Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. God, the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God, the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God, the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we who fill our lives with your ideals be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we perceive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth. By following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. I welcome you here on this, the last weekend of winter. And it was a nice, exciting week, and we're still proceeding through Lent. This is about halfway point. Middle of this week is the actual halfway point of our Lenten journey. And so as we do gather at this time for the celebration of Mass, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And may we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, O God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins for which I have been with you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, the Martyrs, the faithful, who have lived, suffered, and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, to witness my confession and pray for me to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, that with purity of heart we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said that where two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we recite together. Let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, invisible, revealed in triune God, for all time, now, and forever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, God, our ancestor, for you have called us to journey from bondage to freedom. As in former time, you satisfied the bitter thirst of your people, so now quench our thirst with the water of eternal life. We ask for our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is from the Old Testament book of Exodus. But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt? To kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock at the Oreb. Strike the rock and water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. He split rocks in the desert, gave water to drink, abounding as the deep. He made streams flow from crags and threw out rivers of water. On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood up and exclaimed, "Let anyone who thirsts come to me and drink.
Whoever believes in me, as Scripture says,
cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God. You cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim this holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you.
Jesus left Judea and returned to Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of land that Jacob had given to his son Joseph, and Jacob's well was there. Jesus, tired from his journey, sat down there at the well, and it was about noon. A woman of Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." And his disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How can you, a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? For Jews use nothing in common with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God, who is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." And the woman said to him, "Sir, you do not even have a bucket, and this cistern is deep. Where then can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this cistern and drank from it himself with his children and his flocks?" And Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I will give will never thirst. The water I shall give will be a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to come here to this well every day." And Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." And the woman answered and said to him, "I do not have a husband." And Jesus answered her, "You are right in saying, 'I do not have a husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you are now with is not even your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem." And Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we do understand, because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, and indeed the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. And the woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, the one who is called the Anointed One. When he comes, he will tell us everything. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one that you are speaking about. At that moment, his disciples returned and were amazed that he was talking with a woman. But still, no one said, what are you looking for, or why are you talking to her? And the woman left her water jar and went into the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I have ever done. Could he possibly be the Messiah? They went out of the town and came to Jesus. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food enough to eat which you do not know. So the disciples said to one another, could someone have brought him something to eat? And Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say in 4 months the harvest will be here? I tell you, look up and see that the fields are ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving his payment in gathering crops for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper can rejoice together. For here the saying is verified, that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done your work, and you are sharing the fruits of their work. Many of the Samaritans of that town began to believe in Jesus because of the word of the woman who had testified about him. He told me everything that I have ever done, she said. When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them, and he stayed there for 2 days. Many more began to believe in Jesus because of his word, and they said to the woman, we no longer believe because of your word, for now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this truly is the Savior of the world. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Trying to avoid any more problems. The chore of going down to the well and drawing water was woman's work in Jesus' day, and the women of the village would head out to the well in the coolness of the early morning. And this had a double benefit. It sure beat the heat of carrying that heavy water back up to the village, and it was also a time to socialize. And all of the women in the village would be there, and there would not be many other opportunities throughout the day where these women could get together outside of their homes. But the woman that Jesus meets is out drawing water, says the Bible, at high noon. It sure seems like she's going out of her way to avoid meeting any of the other women in the village. We know why. She had gone through five husbands. Now, this didn't have to be her fault, but we can easily imagine why others would have been thinking that she's responsible for this. Whether it be true or not, you can imagine the gossip. So on top of this, she was also not married to the man with whom she was now living. And this all adds up to scandal. And this could have been the kind of material that would have made the rounds down at the well, all of this talk about the scandal associated with this woman. So the woman that Jesus met drawing water at high noon, she didn't want to go down there because of the scandal, and the others probably didn't want her there anyway because of the scandal. But now Jesus enters into the story and into her life. John's Jesus is not as shy about his supernatural gifts as he is in the other Gospels. And on this occasion, Jesus has the gift of supernatural knowledge. He knows this woman's story even before he meets her. Jesus knows why the others are shunning her, but not Jesus. He breaks every social and moral convention there is when he talks to her simply as a person. Even she is amazed that a Jew would talk with her, a Samaritan. As it says in the text, Jewish people and Samaritans would not even share the same utensils. And so, if you really want a good example, think about the old laws down in the South where you had a white person's water fountain and a colored person's water fountain. It's the same thing. The Jews and the Samaritans would not even share the same drinking cup. And when Jesus' disciples return, they're not amazed so much by this odd scene of a Jew and a Samaritan being friendly. What they're amazed at is Jesus is taking the time to talk to a woman. So there was every reason for Jesus to avoid this person. She had moral impropriety. She was a detested Samaritan, and she was a woman. But Jesus, he saw a person there beside the well. He didn't see an adulteress. He didn't see a Samaritan. He didn't see a woman. Jesus saw a person, and Jesus treated her as a person. All of the reasons for separation and judgment, they melted away because Jesus chose not to let them define this person as automatically other. He refused to reject her because of categories, and he simply talked to her by the well of Jacob as a person. And what if it is really as simple as that? Just seeing other people as people. What if as Christians we could learn this lesson of Jesus? There's so much talk in our world today of separation. What if we instead chose not to listen to all of the arguments about why we should not associate with this person or that person, not accept this group or that group, and instead we as Christians follow Jesus' example of looking past categories and simply started talking to other people. When you heard today's gospel, did you take notice of the detail that Jesus and his disciples were making their way from Judea in the south to Galilee, their home region up in the north, but says the Bible, they had to go through Samaria. The only reason they stopped was because Jesus got tired. This wasn't a planned stop. They didn't want to stop, they needed to stop. And then did you hear that the disciples, that they left to buy food? Well, there's a Samaritan village that's not too far away, but the disciples seem to have gone somewhere else because they're gone for a while. Now, the women come from the village down to the well, they get the water, they go back, so it couldn't have been that village. They must have purposely avoided that Samaritan village, so they didn't go into the town of Sychar. The disciples had chosen separation, not because they knew and disliked the people of Sychar, but because they were of the category of Samaritan. And notice what they overlooked. When Jesus' disciples, when they would not go into that village, and this woman would, a whole community came to believe in Jesus. Remember, this woman was hated up in that village. It could not have been easy for her to go back to them and convince them who Jesus was, but she went anyway. In this sense, she, not the 12, but she was the apostle. She was the one sent out to bring others to Christ. Fear, distrust, dislike of others just because of their category, that led nowhere. But when Jesus chose to talk to that person by the well, and when she then followed the example of Jesus and went to that town, to those people who despised her, and she talked to them, then Jesus rejoiced in the hearts of people who came to believe. Maybe part of doing the work of God is as simple as talking to other people and not avoiding them as categories. That we may be open and receptive to the encounters in all parts of our lives, then we fight against that human tendency to treat others as categories and not as people. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord, as we gather before your altar on this third Sunday of Lent, we offer our prayers for Frank Parish, who is battling cancer, as offered by George and Janet Sadowski. We offer prayers for Helen Pislowski on the anniversary of her birth, March 17th, as offered by Peg and Joe Kuschka. We offer prayers in memory of Irving Molesky, who passed away this past week, as offered by Teresa Belisle. We offer prayers in memory of Jenny Wilka on the 7th anniversary of her passing, as offered by her daughter, Carolyn Rapley. We offer prayers for a speedy recovery of Jenny DeMera, as requested by her family. Jenny is currently recovering down at Bay State Medical Center in Springfield. We also offer prayers for Liz Richmond, battling cancer and raising three young girls on her own, Alex, a 16-year-old with lymphoma Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, as offered by Cindy Benjamin. We offer our prayers for Frank Sprosky, offered by the Sprosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We offer prayers for the health and well-being of Bishop Thomas Gannat, and also for that of his wife, Catherine, as offered by myself. And we offer prayers for those battling cancer, Meg Connors, by Ellen and Don Sprosky, Maurice Lazelle, as offered by myself, Richard Poe, is offered by the Poe and Foster families, and 2-year-old Jack Soleil is offered by Mariana Foster. Are there any other prayers you'd like to offer from the congregation? For all of our prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we bring before you in the privacy of our own thoughts, plus we ask you, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to be with those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today, and those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the Spirit, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Let the one who thirsts come forward, and the one who wants it receive the gifts of life-giving water. Receive from your most sacred hands, most gracious Father, the sacramental bread, with the same faith and trust that the apostles and disciples of your Son have seen.
Give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Through our fasting, you increase divine life within us. You preserve us from sin and lead us unto eternal life. Through our abstinence, you confirm us in goodness and curb our unbridled vices. As we commemorate this 40-day fast of your Son, may we together with him give you glory. Therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the saints and the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, 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 God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, most humbly beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with your priests and all true believers in the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, we unite in spirit with all of those, beginning the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise his apostles and with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life and his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, and united with you through prayer in this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time have fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment, when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with it a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is my Father who gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temple and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those whom he had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer in the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word and my Father will love him. We will come to him and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you. I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, where I am to see this glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you." Like manner after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy, venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith that they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask you, Almighty God, to command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with your blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith, and who have passed on into eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life. And to those who are in life straight from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their sufferings. We ask in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts are always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after the divine master, merit in eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning in our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever. Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence, peace of the Lord be with you all. Jesus Christ, bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Do not look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment, though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives, reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given to me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, and I shall be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy, you should enter into my house, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy, you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy, you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Body and blood.
Bye.
why you will draw water at the fountain of your salvation. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the rock of our salvation. May we who partake in the sacred mysteries of this Mass find our delight and our refreshment in you alone. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the tribute of our worship be pleasing to you, most holy Trinity. Grant that the sacrifice which I, though unworthy, have offered in the sight of your majesty be acceptable to you. Through your mercy may it be effective for myself and all of those for whom I have offered it, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory be to you, Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was in God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came into being, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life in the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe. But only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, yet his own did not accept him. And he did accept him, empowered to become children of God. These are they who believe in his name, who begot not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's willingness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son coming from the Father, filled with enduring love. Thanks be to God.